It has been 1 year since the death of Scarlet and Violet's mother. Life has remained unpredictable as ever, and the battle between predator and prey remains a constant one. This is a river leading to the western interior seaway that now divides North America. It remains a vital source of water for dinosaurs, and a favorite pit stop for migrating pterosaurs. This is an Azdarchid Pterosaur, a type of large, short-tailed pterosaur that normally travels the coast in search of fish. Today, however, this one finds a place to rest its wings by the river. He remains vigilant. Although tyrannosaurs are a major threat on land, the rivers that lead into the seaway harbor their own terrifying predators. The pterosaur escapes just in time, but all too often these animals are caught and dragged to their deaths underwater by monstrous crocodilians. Further inland, the dinosaurs go about their lives. An Edmontonia forages for succulent growth. Edmontonia are solitary animals, and rarely interact with other dinosaurs, including fellow herbivores. This is especially the case with the highly aggressive males of the species, like this one. Watching the armored giant is Modoc, clearly looking for something to sink his teeth into. But the Edmontonia is far too dangerous for him to take on. He then comes across an interesting sight. A pair of bull Achelousaurus are trying to intimidate one another to get at a nearby female. Their head frills are home to a web of blood vessels, so when threatened or excited, they flush blood into their frills, putting on a dynamic display of color. But when showing off doesn't work, the males will resort to brute force. When it comes to dinosaurs, the ceratopsians are among the most iconic and most diverse of them all. During the late Cretaceous, North America was home to a wide variety of these animals, each species distinguished by their own set of frills and bodily ornaments. The purpose of such adornments remains a mystery, but many scientists suppose that their primary function was to attract mates and differentiate between species, while also providing protection from marauding tyrannosaurs. still a bit too big. Elsewhere, the Prosaurolophus herd heads down to a river to quench their thirst. Although they tend to feed on land-dwelling plants, Prosaurolophus are quite happy eating water reeds, which varies their diet. Even so, this is a short stop, and the leader decides that it's time to leave. Besides, it's risky coming down here to drink near dark, muddy waters. Scarlet calls to Violet, but she has strayed too far from the safe zone. At 10 meters long and weighing up to 8.5 tons, this is Deinosuchus rugosus, the largest crocodilian to ever live in North America. Violet never stood a chance. Four years pass. For the Prosaurolophus herd, life has been relatively easy. The youngster that joined the herd with her lost mother is now an adolescent, around Scarlet's age when they first met. Scarlet has also grown much over the past few years. She is now a fully grown adult Prosaurolophus, measuring a full 9 meters in length. Now, at 10 years old, she has reached sexual maturity, and this makes her attractive to wandering males. This young male has followed this herd in the hopes of mating with one of the young females. He finds Scarlet. Once he mates with her, his job is done. But for Scarlet, the next several months will change her life forever. This is the Western Interior Seaway, the body of water that now divides North America. It is here, on the eastern coast of present-day Montana, where the Prosaurolophus gather to nest and lay their eggs. For the nesting mothers, the first order of business is finding a good spot to build a nest. Inexperienced in the art of making a nest, Scarlet appears lost. But perhaps watching the more experienced adults can give her some sort of inspiration. After an hour and a half, Scarlet is ready to lay. It's a small clutch, but it's an investment for the future. The idea that dinosaurs took care of their young was a topic of discussion within the scientific community, but it would not be until 1977 when the first pieces of evidence for this sort of behavior actually appeared. During that year, Marion Brandvold, owner of the Rock Shop in Bynum, Montana, discovered the remains of juvenile dinosaurs in an area that would eventually be named, appropriately enough, Egg Mountain. She showed the fossils to paleontologist Jack Horner. Horner and his team would end up discovering not just juvenile dinosaurs, but 14 dinosaur nests in one single area. This was evidence that at one time, this was a nesting ground, a place where herbivorous dinosaurs would congregate to lay their eggs and raise their young, much like modern-day birds. Going to the baby dinosaurs, their bones indicated that they were not yet fully developed, therefore couldn't leave the nest the moment they hatched. This implies that the mother had to watch over them for an extended period of time, feeding and protecting them until they could walk on their own. It was because of this reason that the dinosaur in question would be named Myosaura, meaning good mother lizard. Other sites with similar hadrosaurs show a pattern in behavior, and there is evidence that other groups of dinosaurs, like theropods and ceratopsians, may have also taken good care of their young from the moment they were laid as eggs. The Egg Mountain site remains a landmark in dinosaur paleontology. It provides evidence that dinosaurs were capable of taking care of their young, and shows that dinosaurs were more complex than what many may believe. But where there are nests, there are also nest raiders. A Saurornitholestes eyes the colony. From experience, he knows that nests, isolated from the additional protection of other mothers, are far easier to rob than those in the middle of the colony. As it happens, Scarlet's nest is one of them. After 1 month, life has become more hectic at the nesting grounds. Scarlet's chicks have hatched. All over the beach, newly hatched Prosaurolophus chicks call frantically for their mothers to provide them with food. Scarlet's chicks are no different. The Saurornitholestes returns. It's a bittersweet rescue. One of Scarlet's chicks is severely wounded. She may not survive the night. It takes another year for Scarlet and her herd to leave the nesting grounds. Today, she has someone special tagging along. Youngsters that survived the past year now scamper among the adults. Scarlet's chick has a long journey ahead of her, but so long as her mother can protect her well, she will grow up to return to this nesting ground and raise her own chicks. In Scarlet's old neighborhood, a herd of Gryposaurus joins a trio of Styracosaurus. These males are jousting for mating rights to this female. None of this concerns the hadrosaurs, however, and they continue to feed. Gryposaurus are unique hadrosaurs, as they possess a strange nasal boss, which, when inflated with air, can amplify sound. A quick snort helps keep the herd at peace. But for these herbivores, peace is merely an illusion. Because here, one dinosaur reigns supreme. Modoc the Daspletosaurus. He may not be fully grown, but at 16 years of age, he is big enough and strong enough to take on the toughest herbivores around, no matter how well armed. But Modoc was not the only Daspletosaurus hunting the herd. This male is a little older than him, but Modoc won't willingly give up his prize. All too often, confrontations such as these end in severe injury or death. Modoc is lucky to have escaped with his life. A week passes since the Prosaurolophus returned from the nesting grounds, and the afternoon finds Scarlet and her herd feeding by the river that claimed Violet's life 5 years ago. Scarlet and her baby currently feed on the new growth of the wet season. The juvenile Prosaurolophus that once forced Scarlet to share food with her years earlier comes to sneak in a bite. But Scarlet is not the pushover she used to be. She cannot afford to be. Not when her old nemesis is stalking the herd. After 6 long years, Scarlet and Modoc reunite once more, and this time, there will be no interferences. The resident Daspletosaurus returns. The skirmish is over, and Scarlet remains alive. But all is not lost for Modoc. Hadrosaurs would remain an enormously successful group of herbivores for the last several million years of the Mesozoic, perhaps assisted by their ability to care for their offspring. As more sites like Egg Mountain are discovered, we are able to take a unique look into the life histories of these and many other dinosaurs. The Ceratopsians, too, would live on as one of the chief families of herbivorous dinosaurs for the remainder of the Mesozoic, eventually giving rise to such famous species as Triceratops. And Daspletosaurus and his kin would live on as the apex predators of North America, until eventually, their adaptability would lead to the evolution of one of the largest and most powerful theropod dinosaurs to ever walk the planet. It will be the descendants of this new bloodline of dinosaurs who will dominate the planet for the remainder of the Mesozoic, unchallenged and as adaptable as ever. For Scarlet the Prosaurolophus and her offspring, life has given, and will continue to give, opportunities to learn from past mistakes and continue their genetic line. And for Modoc the Daspletosaurus, his triumph in becoming the ruler over this domain has come with its own share of rewards. It's a scene reminiscent of a time when our heroes were mere youngsters. For this savage and untamed American generation, they have succeeded where others have failed, and only time will tell who or what will come next.